Good evening. I am a depressed man with a smiling face. The reason is that I have worked for more than 40 years to make the world sustainable, and I have failed. The world is less sustainable today than when I started my hard work in 1970. And this is most easily seen in the area of climate change. Humanity is emitting into the atmosphere twice as much CO2 every year as is being absorbed by the oceans and the forests of the world. The remaining one half of this CO2 is accumulating in the atmosphere with a half-life of several hundred years. And as the concentration of CO2 increases, the temperature increases. And this will continue not only until we stop emitting CO2 into the atmosphere, but until we have extracted from the atmosphere all the excess CO2 that we have put into the atmosphere over the last 250 years. This makes me depressed. I have learned, however, from my lovely wife, that I should smile, because this conveys the message much better. So I smile. More than 40 years ago, my friends and I wrote The Limits to Growth. The Limits to Growth contains 12 scenarios for the world from the year 1970 to the year 2100. Six of these scenarios are sad scenarios where something went wrong in the 21st century. We ran out of resources, there were too many people, too little food, too much pollution. Six of the scenarios were positive scenarios where humanity, you know, came to its senses and actually created a world which was more or less sustainable, where the quality of life actually maintained at relatively high levels throughout the century. At the time, we did not know enough, one did not know enough, to tell which of these 12 scenarios was the most likely. Consequently, all we could do was to recommend to humanity that they try to keep away from the sad futures and try to concentrate attention on the positive futures. We're now 40 years down the line, and I can report to you that we know a lot more. And one of the things we know is that humanity has not heeded our advice. The world has continued to expand its population, to expand its GDP, to expand its consumption, and to expand its ecological footprint. And it's the latter thing, which is the most important thing. We have systematically increased the annual resource use and the annual emissions, the pollution of the atmosphere. However, there has been some advance during these 40 years. We have gradually at least started to focus some attention on the negative side effects of this growth. And there is, of course, some progress. But the progress is too slow. You know, the problems are accumulating faster than we are solving them. I must smile, because my wife says I must smile. And so consequently, slide number two is the optimistic slide. Just basically says that, please remember, in spite of the stupid behavior of humanity, and particularly the rich countries, and particularly the capitalists of the world, over the last 40 years, a much better future is possible. And all it takes to solve the climate problem, which is the hardest problem to solve, is to shift 2% of the labor and capital of the world from dirty sectors to clean sectors. There are umpteen reports that have done the calculation and gets to the number between 1 and 2%. So what we need to do is to take the people and the capital that presently makes fossil cars and make them make electric cars. We need to take the people and the capital that currently builds fossil-fired plants, power plants, to build windmills and solar panels. We need to take the carpenters that in our stinking rich country of Norway are building huge bungalow with thin walls, force them to make smaller bungalows with thicker walls. People like I and others who have done the calculations know it only takes a 2% shift to do this. However, this, as point three said, sadly, it is difficult to find support for this shift in the market because these actions are less profitable than following the traditional way, and in democratic society, because people are not in support of those tax increases that are necessary in order to change the frame conditions in such a way that it becomes profitable to invest in the green sector. And that's where we are. The short-term nature of the human being, as reflected in capitalism, the market, and in democracy, is holding us back from doing those investments today. That shift of the 2% of labor and capital from dirty to clean, that would solve the problem very smoothly over the next 40 years. Now you can go to sleep. This is what I wanted to say. And if long experience in talking about these issues had not taught me that it is very inefficient to start the discussion at this point, I would have done so. But in order, it has taken 40 years, you know, to get the public debate on these issues to a level which is beyond that of a Neanderthaler person, you know, or a very young person. And so I think I'll just go through the reasoning a little more detailed so that the discussion afterwards can be slightly more elevated. I am arrogant. I know I am arrogant. I am an upper-class Norwegian, and we are arrogant. So please excuse me, but it helps because people listen to arrogant people and smiling people. The plan. What is likely to happen over the next 35 years? I will tell you, and I'm right. What needs to be done to improve on this future? What forces will work against this solution? And that's the important point, that you understand that the obvious pious wishes for the future that has been expressed time and again by you and others of your inclination and my inclination, who is against this? And that's the vast majority. For what can be done to reduce this resistance, which is the important point, and then what should the Club of Rome do in this picture? As I see it, at this point in time, the world is facing two big challenges. The two challenges is poverty on one hand, and it is climate change on the other thing. There are many other problems in the world. There is unemployment, there is corruption, there is human rights, there is women's rights, there is, you name it, there are many other problems. In my mind, those two problems, poverty alleviation and handling the climate issues, are even more important than the others. Because if you solve the others and you do not solve the poverty problem or the climate problem, you know, the world will come to some kind of half end in both cases. So these are the important thing. And the important thing, as I said, these things are simple to solve in principle, should be done. Let me further repeat before I go into the forecast my frame of mind so that you understand why I am a depressed person with a smiling face. I was asked by the Prime Minister of Norway in 2005 to run a royal commission to make the plan for how Norway could cut its greenhouse gas emissions by 60% by 2050. This was 2 years before the Stern report. This was the first time any government ever had asked the correct question, and I was asked to answer it with an eight-person commission. We worked for 18 months. We came up with a very elegant solution. There were 15 decisions that the parliament needed to do. If those 15 decisions had been implemented, Norway would reduce its greenhouse gas emissions by 60% from 25 to, beyond 1990 levels, you know, by 2050. The bill, €250 per Norwegian per year. That was the cost of doing this. I spent 4 years of my life trying to convince the stupid Norwegian population, you know, that it was a great deal, stinking rich as we are, egalitarian as we are, freely educated as we are, free health system for 60 years as we have had. You know, to spend €250 per person per year in order to solve the biggest problem of the rich world in a way that could totally inland without the use of quotas, in a way that could be copied by other rich countries. 4 years, totally wasted. Finally, we got a special purpose party established in Norway, who ran for this program. 2.8% voted in favor of the... So it means that 96.2% of Norwegians are so short-term that they are not willing to sacrifice the next shopping trip to London, you know, in order to go for a solution for their children or their grandchildren. When this dawned to me, it was when I then jumped ship and started writing 2052. I wanted to tell people, you know, what kind of future you are creating for yourself. You're not listening to my great advice. You're doing silly things. Here is what will happen. And that's what I'm going to tell you, because this is what is going to happen, because I no longer believe that people are actually going to change their mind and start to behave in a long-term fashion. The problem with this talk is that it's too long, but that's the way it is. The book is 2052. It's a report to the Clover Rome, like most other interesting papers. It is out in 8 languages. It sells best in China and South Korea and Japan and Germany. It has no market whatsoever. It has sold 20,000 copies in England or in the Anglo-Saxon tradition. You know, the liberal market people don't think this is a good idea. But in China, I travel a lot speaking about this, and it works very well. What will happen? Fertility, the number of children born to the average woman, is going to continue its dramatic decline from the last 40 years. All graphs, those who like graphs, look at the graphs. Those who do not like graphs, listen to what I say. I say everything which is important. The graphs are just there to impress you. There is a lot of thinking behind this, much more than you would ever think. It's all freely available on the web, the book website, www.2052.info. This is history, 1970 to 2010, and this is my forecast to the right. The number of children per woman is going to continue dropping like a stone in the rich world, because women will continue to choose a career rather than more children. You will not have those that fought and more. And in the poor world, the fertility rate is going to decline, because poor women now live in slums. In urban slums, not in the village. In the urban slum, it's incredibly expensive to have children, and the fertility rates are coming down. As a consequence, the world population will peak in 2040, around 8 billion people. On the economy side, we will have slow GDP growth in the world over the next 40 years, much slower than the 3.5% average real growth rate that we have had over the last 40 years. In the rich world, there will be hardly any expansion at all, and in some of the emerging economies, rapid growth, and the rest of the world, perfectly ordinary. What is going on is the following. First of all, the workforce will, of course, stagnate and start to decline because it moves in parallel with the population. Secondly, productivity growth, the GDP per person year, is going to grow. So productivity is going to grow much more slowly in the rich world over the next 40 years than over the last 40 years because we have now most of the labor force in services, culture, and care. Sorry, services, health, and care, and culture. Areas where there is no possibility of enhancing productivity. We did the easy stuff in the past, increasing productivity in agriculture, moving people into industry, increasing the productivity through capital, et cetera, moving them into simple office work. Now we're moving, you know, the computers into the simple office work, moving the people into the health sector, et cetera, et cetera. This is going on very elegantly. Robotization over the next 15 years is going to get rid of most of the financial analysts in addition to, you know, the banking people, because, of course, machines do this much better than you know, ordinary human beings. And all of us will be out here in entertainment, restaurants, et cetera. Where productivity growth is slow, and since the number of people is stable, GDP will not grow as fast. China, very differently, will, of course, expand until they have completed, they have copied the development of Japan and South Korea over the last 50 years. Thirdly, the world will have to spend money on an increasing number of reparations, basically. When the sea level starts to rise, the Dutch will have to spend money, that means labor and capital, on expanding the dikes. So, you know, this basically means that we will have to use labor and capital on cleaning the air, on getting access to more expensive resources, or to build dikes in Holland, or as the Americans are doing at the time, you know, new dikes in front south of Manhattan to avoid the water to go into this New York subway, you know, in the future. There are a number of bills that we have been trying to postpone that we can't postpone. And there's no difficulty, it's easy enough to do this. You should just remember that that manpower and that capital cannot be used to produce clothing and plastic toys and, you know, useless other consumer goods and services. You know, it's a restructuring of the economy. And of course, if you want to invest wisely, one of the things you should do is to understand this, that that's where the growth is going to be, in the unavoidable repair and adaptation sectors. Those sectors that are not ordinary, classical demand, you know, this is state purchases of common goods. That's where the growth is going to be. Once I know what the GDP, sorry, the energy efficiency, the energy intensity of the economy is going to continue to sink. The green line shows that the energy use per unit of GDP has been coming down at roughly 1% a year over the last 40 years. It will continue to go down at 1% a year in the future, both because we know it's technically possible and because it is, of course, desirable to save some energy in most cases. And as a consequence, since we know what the GDP will do, we know what the total energy use will be. It will peak in 2040, and in 2050, the world will be using less energy than it used 20 years before. If I had a lot of time, I would have shown you, I don't think it is, I would have shown you this graph, shows that what will happen over the next 40 years is that renewables, the yellow line, will gradually squeeze out oil, you know, which is where the consumption will be stable, measured in tons per year, you know, over the next 15 years, coal, which will expand for a while due to China and then go down, and gas, which will be expanding relatively quickly because it will be used as a transition fuel. But gradually, the expansion of the renewables will squeeze out the rest. And they will not disappear because of lack of coal, oil, and gas. You know, the amount of coal, oil, and gas that will be used to the year 2050 is roughly one half of what is already booked in the balance sheets of the energy companies of the world. So one half of what is ascribed value by the stupid market, you know, at this point in time, is actually without value. This is what is called the carbon bubble, you know, in most other cases. But it's, of course, much worse than most people think. But it's so far out in time that with current discount rates, this is not seen. Since I know what the energy consumption is going to look like, it's easy to calculate what will be the CO2 emissions from energy. And it will reach a peak in 2030. And it will be not cut by 50 to 80% by 2050, which is the ambition of Paris and all other places. It will be cut by zero. The only difference is that at this point in time, global emissions go up by 2% a year, 2 to 3% a year. And in the future, in 2050, it will be going down by 2 to 3% a year, and probably down to zero around the year 2100. And once I know what are the CO2 emissions, it is, of course, easy to calculate how warm it is going to get. You just use one of the big computer models and input the CO2. And here is the proof, you know, or the, here is the result, sorry, not the proof, this is the result. We are currently at plus 0.8 degrees centigrade relative to pre-industrial times. We will pass through plus 2 degrees centigrade in 2050. And if you run this system further out in time, we will peak at plus 3 degrees centigrade in 2080. And then it will stay at that level for a couple of hundred years, unless we use CCS to take the CO2 out of the atmosphere. Is this bad? Yes, this is very bad. Is this a sudden catastrophe that is going to kick democracy and the market into action? No. This is the horrible situation where we get more and more extreme weather, warmer and warmer days in Berlin, and then it rains the next week, and then it's drought in the growing season just outside. Or it's the type of life where peasants don't know what to plant at what point in time. The bird doesn't know when it should go south or go north or whatever. This is messy, irritating, unpleasant, but not catastrophical. Sadly, you know, because what society needs, in my mind, is a real kick in the ass, you know, to get off this illusory, you know, dream that we are pursuing. Sorry, I forgot to smile. So, from a positive point of view, this means that there will be no catastrophe over the next 40 years. It just gets worse and worse, but we will handle it. We will just be inside instead of being outside. The important thing, I've this far, for the sake of brevity, talked about the global average. Things will evolve exceedingly differently in the five regions of the world. And if you want to read more about it, read the book, because there are pages and pages on each of these sectors. The United States, it's probably more logical to do it the other way around. China will do very well. The average Chinese will be five times as rich in 2050 as that person is at this point in time, because of the perfect alignment of the intention of the Communist Party of the China and the interest of the ordinary Chinese. Both want to get rich as fast as possible. Since this is technically possible, it will be done. And the easiest way to understand what's going on in China at this point in time, China is, of course, pursuing the path blazed by Japan who moved its society in an organized fashion from agriculture society to post-industrial society from 1950 to 1990. South Korea did the same thing from late 50s to late 1990s. China started on exactly the same expedition, you know, from a much worse base in 1982, and they're roughly one third of the way. Much like Japan and South Korea, this is a centrally planned move from agriculture to post-industrial. Just like Japan and South Korea, the Chinese are going to succeed. The US is going to have a hard time. The US is, of course, the richest economy of the world, which means that they have moved most of the labor force into the soft, soggy, hopeless areas of services, health, and care. And they will not experience much productivity work. Progress, and they will have to pioneer, you know, how you run a very rich society, which is where productivity does not evolve, and where the only predictable result is increasing differences between me and my friends, the elite, and the rest of the people. So, in my mind, the US is a two-class society by 2050, where I and my friends live in gated cities, and the medium, the average person, lives outside with an even lower annual salary than he has today. As you know, car workers in the United States make the same now as they did when I left that wonderful country in 1974. I'm educated in the United States, as you know. I love the country that existed in 1974. In case you have bad memory like I have, this is what you should remember. This is, so when someone asks you tonight, what did he say? He said that the world population and economy will grow more slowly towards 2052 than most people expect, but still fast enough to trigger a climate crisis. And then he said that consumption will stagnate because society will have to spend ever more labor and capital on repair and adaptation. And then he said that the short-term nature of man, reflected in the short-term focus of democracy and capitalism, is the root cause of this development. What needs to be done? Two things. You need to remove poverty, and you need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. These are the highest priority of humanity at this point in time. Only a few hints on the road. Concerning removing poverty, it needs to be done both in the rich and the poor world, because the frictions between, you know, the increasing disparity that has become so much more famous since I wrote this book because of Piketty, you know, is going to do great damage to the liberal markets of the world. And the poor world, most people do agree that it's important to try to lift them out of poverty. How should this be done? I don't have very much advice except using, you know, continuing to use the traditional methods, which haven't worked well in the past, but is the best we can do, with perhaps one addition, that we should start building renewable capacity in the poor world and give it to people. People don't get a higher standard of living because of human rights. They do get higher standard of living if you give them electricity, which basically means give them sun and give them wind and give them bio. The third point I wanted to make, one should have much more respect over the next 40 years for centrally planned solutions. You know, when Western society brags about the fact that many of the Millennium Development Goals have actually been reached, they are also always embarrassingly mute on the fact that most of this success is inside China. It's the 1.3 billion Chinese that have been lifted. You know, it is not those that are pursuing democratic market solutions in the rest of the world. On the reduced greenhouse gas emissions side, you know, it's important to get it down. And here, it is, of course, important to start in the rich world. We can afford, we emit most, or at least much, most per capita. This means very, very simply, it is not difficult to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It's just to stop using coal, oil, and gas. And that's all. So whenever you use directly one of these fossil fuels, directly or embedded, that's wrong. Shift to something else. There exist alternative solutions to everything. What's the problem? It is more expensive than using coal, oil, and gas. And that's the only thing that is holding us back. So this means, to be concrete, increase energy efficiency, the renewable fraction, and CO2 capture and storage, which will be necessary in order to draw down the concentration in the atmosphere once we have finally gotten to the point of slowing to zero. The final note is here in order to help the impact investors here. You know, the only thing you should invest in are things that lowers the energy use per GDP or lowers the CO2 per unit of energy. That's the test you should subject any proposal to. If it can't fly past those, you should shy away, in my mind. So the solution is totally obvious. Remove poverty and cut the use of coal, oil, and gas. We have been trying this for the last... we have been trying to reduce poverty for the last 50 years, and we've been trying to reduce climate emissions for the last 25 years. One has to become 70 years old of age, you know, before one starts understanding why this is so difficult. The reason is, of course, that most people aren't interested at all in these two things happening. And let's take the case of climate, because that's what is most interesting in the rich world where we, after all, belong. So who are against solving the climate problem? There are two groups. First of all, it's the incumbents in the dirty sectors. And it's both the workers in the coal mines, it's the worker in the offshore area in Norway, and the owners. And the owners have finally gotten smart enough that they shut up, because they know that their workers will fight for jobs. You know, so you don't even have to say anything when you own Statoil. You know, the Statoil workers are, of course, fiercely against any attempt in Norway to start reducing the oil and gas production. Dirty, in this sense, includes, of course, Ernst's resource-intensive sector. So it's energy-intensive, it's CO2-intensive, it's pollution-intensive, it's resource-intensive. It's, you know, those sectors that produce a lot of bads along with the intended good that needs to be cut. And then, sadly, there is the second category, which is even bigger, because the incumbents in the dirty sectors are only like 5% of the population. So in a democracy, they should easily be voted down by the remaining 95. But then you have the second category, and those are the people who dislike high taxes and strong government. Because clearly, you know, either you introduce a high CO2 price, which is a tax, or you introduce regulation. And very many people are against taxes and against regulations. In other words, against a strong government. There are many. I should have said a few are principled, you know, against this. Some, most, base this on egoism. They would rather, like, as I said, go shopping in London than paying 250 euros, you know, to the state to clean up the environment. And most are based on short-term perspective, on societal development, as I already said. How could this be done? So these are the forces. What can we do to reduce the resistance against what in my mind is totally obvious, you know, the way we ought to have done this? Well, since most of these solutions are more expensive than doing nothing, you know, then continuing, you know, one, you need some kind of help, you know, to get them going. And as I said, since most people are against, you know, these added increased taxes or added regulations, you need to find solutions that are smart enough that they provide a short-term benefit to a majority of voters. And let me give you some ideas, because you would immediately say that this is not possible, you know, to find something that both solves the problem in the long run and provides a benefit in the short term. The most sexy example, and one that we know works, is to lure people to buy expensive electric cars by saying that if you have an electric car, you can drive in the bus lane. So in other words, people are more, at least in our country where we have introduced this, you know, people are willing to buy cars that are twice as expensive as the other car because it comes with the right to drive in the bus lane so that you can save another 10 minutes, you know, on road to, which is a smart move. And we are now, Norway is now approaching, Norway has 5 million inhabitants, so it's 1/20th of you. We are now approaching 100,000 electric vehicles. That would be the same as you having 2 million electric vehicles on the road at this point in time with your whatever incentive systems you have put in place. So that's zero. Okay. Of course. And why? Could someone know? Please stand up and say this is because of the workers and the owners of the fossil-based German automobile industry. Thank you. No need. I am intelligent, you know, but so there's not a problem. I understand these things, but it may be that others don't. Another thing which works, and this one, interestingly, works in the United States of America. So this is, you know, to convince the Republicans in their big villas, you know, like mine, you know, outside, to put solar panels on the roof, even if that is more expensive than buying from the utility. You know, most Republican Americans hate the utility. And buying energy independence, you know, by putting solar panels or in the back garden somewhere it can't be seen, is actually a sellable proposition, even if the solar energy is high, more expensive. Third solution is the one that Ernst is the father of, and you Germans have demonstrated actually work. And that is the subsidy system, where you lure the population to believe that advantage comes first and the cost comes afterwards. So the way I present the story of the Energiewende around the world in order to, you know, make my point, it's slightly wrong, but it doesn't matter. The point is that Parliament contained in 1999 a few people who thought that Mr. Kohl's idea from 1992 that we should try to become independent from the imports of gas from Soviet Norway and Algeria, you know, these horrible three groups that were about to, you know, start to determine the future of Germany, that we ought to do this, and that we ought to do this with the only energy available, sun and wind. So he started, Mr. Kohl, in the early 1990s. It didn't really work until Ernst and his friends in 1999, with one vote in Bundestag, managed to pass, you know, the subsidy scheme, which is behind the Energiewende. And what is the subsidy scheme? It is basically, and again, excuse my simplification, because it's the simplified version that ought to be introduced in the rest of the world. They basically said that if you own a house and put a solar panel on your roof, we will pay the bill. And if you said to the farmer, if you have a piece of land where you could build a windmill, we will pay the bill. At the end of the year, you know, we will collect all the bills from all of you that have put solar panels in, and we'll divide it by 90 million so that each German pays a 90 millionth of this thing. And this system sounded very nice, you know, because there was no bill immediately, and there was this promise that if, you know, you put the solar panel. Then 3 or 4 years passed, and the bill at the end of the year started to rise. And then the German people, of course, finally understood what was going on. And 4 years into the process, if I am correctly informed, the annual bill was 174 euros per person, per household, per year. And that's when you cried stop, and then this thing stopped. But in between, you know, you had entered enough solar energy and wind in your country to make life incredibly complicated for the operators of the fossil industry, as you know, because the peak pricing disappeared. And so no, the ball is in motion, as they say in the football. I hate football. But you know, things are happening, and no, things will, thanks to Ernst and his friends. So the important thing to learn there, make the subsidy scheme in such a manner that you hide the bill or postpone the bill, and so that upfront. Because, of course, the wonderful thing was that after year two or three, when people started to complain about the annual amount, Ernst and the other guys said, well, if you don't like to pay the bill, why don't you install solar panel and windmill? And that, of course, kept people quiet for another couple of years. Very smart. This is good. Four is the green stimulus package. Since you probably are not interested in issues like this, you know that after the financial crash, you know, stimulus packages were passed in other parts of the world, perhaps even in this country, I don't know. And some of those, these are, of course, the government printing money and asking people to do something. And in South Korea, they printed money and asked people to clean the country. So instead of investing in new roads or investing in more shipbuilding capacity, they basically invested in a thorough cleanup of the country. That's a green stimulus package. That's another thing. This is possible in Parliament because people like jobs in the short term. Whether that job is to increase the dikes of Holland or to produce more plastic toys is very unimportant from the job seeker point of view. So green stimulus packages is probably one of the policies that might solve the problem. I'm soon through. And then comes the final thing, which you don't like, I should not like, but I am ideological, so I like it. That's wealth tax on the top third of the population, you know, used to build low-carbon energy systems, either here or elsewhere, so that you force investments into what is the solution, namely low-carbon energy systems, which then gradually will become so big that they make the fossil industry unprofitable and squeeze them out of the market. Why do I choose the top third? That's because I want a majority. Of course, two-thirds of the population who are not in the top third, they couldn't care less whether, you know, we increase the wealth tax on the top third, so they will not vote against this. You know, and consequently, this is possible to get through. This is free greening of the world, you know. This is free green growth as seen by the majority. I and you will disagree. But in a democracy, this is one, you know, this is the type of solution which you need to use in order to get anywhere. Finally, there was the final question, and that was I had one small paragraph here which I was wondering whether to include or not, since I have the time. Once you have implemented all of these solutions that I indicate, you should be totally aware of the fact that there are two other things you should do. But these are so fiercely resisted that it is, I have found it gradually useless to mention, but I just, for intellectual honesty. The first thing is, of course, to try to further accelerate the decline in fertility. You know, introducing the one-child family in the rich world is one of the things that will draw down the population of big consumers faster than it would otherwise have occurred. The second thing is to shorten the work year, you know, to increase leisure. You know, instead of working 2,000 hours a year for pay or 1,800 hours per year for pay or 1,500, draw it down faster than one did before, because this will, of course, reduce production and will reduce consumption. And or you can do it so that you stabilize production and stabilize consumption, and then gradually technology will reduce the ecological footprint. So smaller, so one-child family in the rich world and shorter work year. For instance, adding two vacation days per year without changes in the salary. It's a way of getting this into society in a way where the discrepancy will be eaten up by excess inflation in a way that you will hardly notice. So that's the, because of the productivity growth. Fine, what is the role of the Club of Rome in all of this? The role of the Club of Rome in all of this is to try to push an acceptable solution. You know, the Club of Rome has been a debating forum, you know, or a platform, so to speak, for most of its life. I think now has come the time where the Club of Rome should start pushing a solution. And that solution, I suggest, should be an acceptable solution rather than pious wishes. There are many other organizations that are pushing pious wishes, you know, dreams that will never be passed in democratic society. The club should push for something that could be agreed. And that is, in my mind, first of all, to focus on the fact that what we need are solutions that are more expensive than the simplest solution available. We need to do those things that are less profitable than the rest. We need to build windmills and sun solar panels when the return on investment using standard discount rates, etc., are lower than it would be if you built a gas-powered utility. That's the first thing. And to try to make people aware of that this is the challenge. The challenge is not to find wildly profitable solutions, because those have already been found. You know, so those that are more profitable than the rest, you know, there have, my friends and you and others have been scouring the environment for the last 30 years, you know, to find the most profitable way of investing. And of course, if there had been anything there, it would have been found. So the task at hand is to do those things that are not yet profitable. And in order to succeed in this, one needs to focus on solutions that have a benefit for a majority of the voters or a majority of the investors, you know, in the short term. Otherwise, we will never get them passed. That was an uninspiring end. That was sad. Let's see, how do I do this? So, because I'd forgotten to smile for a while. So the point, so now you know what will happen, what ought to happen, you know, is more emphasis of you on less profitable projects. I know that this is hard. I know that it needs to be done. I inspire you, to encourage you, or plea to you to try to do something along these lines, because it's very clear that if we manage to move 2% of the labor and capital of the world from dirty to clean, it will solve the problem. And I encourage you to do this, even though if you succeed, my forecast will become wrong. And of course, I'm very proud of my forecast, so this is a very big bet for me to do. Good luck.
Thank you so much, and this is actually what really caught my attention. When I read the book a couple of years ago, when it showed up, when it first appeared, it ended with a call. I want you to prove me wrong. And that was the call for me when I said, I'm going to prove this guy wrong, and I'm going to invite all of you to prove him wrong. So join us, because there is nothing in the world that would make us happier. Thank you.